This team of scientists and engineers are camped above an abandoned Cold War military base that's buried 30 meters below Greenland's ice sheet.
That is Delta storm condition.
They're part of a special climate monitoring program because the underground base that they're studying could eventually thaw out and unearth thousands of tons of toxic waste.
On the top of the world, below the surface of a giant ice cap, a city is buried. This is the story of Camp Century.
During the early years of the Cold War, the U.S. started paying close attention to Greenland. To protect the island from creeping Soviet influence, the U.S. and Denmark signed the 1951 Defense of Greenland Act.
Today, on the island of Greenland, the United States Army has established an unprecedented nuclear-powered Arctic Research Center.
Army personnel put the latest advances in polar construction to the test, building several military bases out on the ice sheet. One of them was Camp Century.
We finally picked this plateau, a smooth white plain of ice for as far as you could see. This was the closest location to Thule, our supply base, which would not be affected by the summer thaw.
Researchers were doing a lot of very fundamental glacier and climate research. Camp Century is probably best known for being home of the first deep ice core to the bed of the Greenland ice sheet. It's like nothing we have today. It was just this phenomenal marriage of technology and innovation in the 1960s.
They built an entire underground city, complete with housing, kitchens, lounges, scientific labs, a chapel, and even a barbershop.
And the whole camp, which could house up to 200 people on a year-round basis, was powered by a nuclear power plant.
The U.S. Atomic Energy Commission invested a ton of R&D into small, portable nuclear power reactors that could be built in remote locations. And Camp Century was the perfect proving ground. The U.S. flew over 400 tons of equipment to Greenland to build a PM2A reactor. And they carefully transported the materials to the base, where scientists then installed it to power the polar camp.
Now here it is. With all five control rods withdrawn 6.24 inches, PM2A, when critical, at 0652 hours.
Camp Century was presented to the world as a heroic conquest of the Arctic in man's never-ending pursuit for knowledge and scientific progress.
They had Walter Cronkite up there doing NewsHour specials back in the 60s. Everybody knew about it. It was no secret.
But this scientific endeavor was actually part of a covert U.S. Army operation, codenamed Project Iceworm. In response to escalating Cold War tensions, the U.S. wanted to position 600 medium-range missiles with nuclear warheads underneath the Greenland ice sheet. All was going according to plan until engineers noticed the ice that surrounded the base was shifting faster than initially projected.
The people who were working at Camp Century did not have an understanding of climate change. They didn't have satellite records, global climate models, these sorts of big data sets that let you see an overview of what's happening to Earth's climate.
The moving ice sheet started to destabilize the underground tunnels, prompting the U.S. Army to abort Project Iceworm.
When Camp Century was decommissioned, only the nuclear reactor was taken out for destructive testing, and the rest of the camp was left in place, and they closed the doors and left. It was abandoned on the assumption that climate wouldn't change, and it would continue to snow at Camp Century forever, and the perpetual snowfall would entomb all of the base infrastructure and eventually bury it.
But the climate has changed. Temperatures have reached record highs in the Arctic, and Greenland's ice sheet is melting at an unprecedented rate, which could turn Camp Century's abandoned waste into a major environmental risk. So, a team of scientists, including William, went back to the site.
In 2017, the government of Denmark, at the request of the government of Greenland, started the Camp Century Climate Monitoring Program. We set up a bunch of instruments that are erected on the ice sheet surface, and then we drill in and we put probes into the ice sheet. It keeps a real-time data stream coming from the Camp Century site, where we monitor a bunch of things, mainly the temperature of the snow, the temperature of the ice, the air temperature properties that'll help us sort of model how the snow and ice at Camp Century is going to behave over the next century.
They also mapped the debris left behind using ice-penetrating radar.
The radar is perhaps the most time-consuming. You have to manually tow it at a slow speed. It sends out a pulse of energy that goes down into the ice, and then it reflects off different things. It comes back to a receiver. It was 80 kilometers in total. That was a lot of radar.
They turned those radar profiles into a 3D map of the entire debris field.
But at Camp Century, you get those horizontal lines of annual accumulation layers, but then you also get these big pockets of chaos. You can see the main tunnels. You can see pieces of debris down to about the size of a vehicle, maybe even a fuel drum. Our preliminary estimate is that we think the debris field is about 55 hectares in size, which is about 100 football fields. And we think it contains just over 9,000 metric tons of debris. We're very interested in how deep everything is and where it is, so that when we go to do our simulations of how much meltwater there might be at the site over the next century and how deep it is going to percolate into the ice sheet. There's concern that if meltwater starts interacting with the debris field, it could mobilize some contaminants.
Those contaminants include diesel fuel, nuclear waste like radioactive coolant water, and other toxic chemicals from the camp's buildings and general infrastructure. And all of that is on track to seep into the environment.
In the 1960s, the building codes were a little different. So we know, for example, that the materials they were using at Camp Century were rich in PCBs and other types of persistent contaminants. They still come out of the ground kicking. I mean, they don't deteriorate at all. We're sort of at a fork in the road for Camp Century. Under the business as usual climate, it looks likely that we will start to see more melt than snowfall at Camp Century by the end of the century. But if we stick with something like Paris Agreement, we can keep more snowfall than melt beyond the end of the century.
This raises questions about who is ultimately responsible for the cleanup. And that leads us into a geopolitical gray area. Camp Century was a U.S. base on Greenland soil, which was governed by Denmark. Currently, no party has taken responsibility for the abandoned base. And international environmental law really hasn't figured something like this out yet.
It's really a microcosm of the multi-generational, even multinational, implications of climate change facing us now. And we have to be very aware of future projections and take action today to go on the high mitigation and low emissions route.
For more science documentaries, check out this one right here. Don't forget to subscribe and keep coming back to Seeker for more videos.